morning, everybody, and welcome to our service at the Stations of the Cross. It's a little different this year because due to restrictions, we cannot walk around to each of the stations, nor can we sing hymns. So we're very grateful to Barry, who has found the resources that we had from Turvey Abbey. They are pictures of each of the stations, and he and Lorraine and I will be reading and praying each of the stations as we click through them. As I said, they're from Turvey Abbey, and they're the inspired illustrations of Christ's journey to the cross. I like them because they are modern. There's an image, and almost like an icon, it's like a symbol through which, when we look at it, we can experience what Christ was going through. The journey to the cross is the story of each person's passage from life to death to life. Thus, from station to station, we are led in meditation on the cross of the world today. And we must always remember that death and resurrection do not only occur when we leave this world, but can and do happen in the daily situations of our lives.
Station 1. Jesus is condemned to death. The eve of the Passion, Jesus' hour of darkness, has come when, all utterly scattered, leaving me alone. The colours suggest a glow of fire somewhere in the high priest's courtyard, where Peter sits warming himself. The cock is crowing, large, red, fierce, and raucous. All Jesus' friends have deserted him. Threatening fists, accusing fingers, are his only reward for his life of healing and teaching. Yet, I am not alone, because the Father is with me. For our sake, God made the sinless one a victim of sin, so that in him we might become the goodness of God. We remember the innocent ones condemned today, victims of war and violence, of earthquake, famine, and fire. We remember the unborn and those we condemn by word or deed and even by our silence, our own brothers and sisters of every race and creed. Lord, we pray for all who are treated unjustly.
Station 2. Jesus takes up his cross. Yet all the horrors of the Passion come swooping down on him at this moment. He stands straight and ready. It was for this reason that I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Jesus lays down his life for the glory of that name, so that we might live and give glory to God. In the stream of suffering engulfing him is also the strength and love of God. Jesus embraces the cross. God embraces him. If anyone wants to be a follower of mine, let him renounce himself, take up his cross, and follow me. How do we accept the cross in our lives? Ill health, loneliness, failure or fear? Do we embrace them as Jesus did? And how do we respond to the suffering in our world, to major tragedies? Do we unite with the victims in our prayer, placing them in the presence of God? Lord, we pray for the strength to bear our cross, knowing that it is your cross we are carrying.
Station 3. Jesus falls the first time. Ours were the sufferings he wore, ours the sorrows he carried. He was not carrying that one and only cross. He was weighed down, crushed by the crosses of all the world. Whatever we suffer, Jesus is carrying the weight of it. He suffers with us. There is no human suffering in which he is not present to redeem it and turn it into the seed of resurrection. The thorns refer to Genesis. Accursed be the soil because of you. It shall yield you brambles and thistles. Jesus came face to face with the curse of paradise. In Mark we read, "Your sins are forgiven. Get up and walk." Thus says Jesus when we fall over and over again through the frailty of our human condition. Are we aware of our weaknesses? Do we pray often for strength to overcome them? We remember those evil regimes and institutions and for individuals manipulated by them. Help all those involved to see the error of their ways. Lord, when we fall, help us to rise and walk once more with you.
Station 4. Jesus meets his mother. the previous one. Mary's nearness breaks through the nightmare with light and love. The colours reflect this. Mary was the one who was most able to help and strengthen him, while Luke tells us the sword pierced her own soul. It is the sword in Mary's heart that now unites mother and son, comforting each other. Only when we know suffering ourselves can we comfort others. And Luke reminds us, let what you have said be done to me. What are Mary's thoughts as she is reunited with her suffering son? Does she not experience and share the pain of all mothers whose children suffer through illness, whose children are missing, whose children are parted from them through national disasters? Does she not share also the pain of children who perhaps through the misunderstanding or a desire to be free of parental control are cut off from their loved ones? Lord, we pray that, as on the way of the cross, you brought Mary and her son together, all families may be united once again in the bond of love.
Station 5, Simon of Cyrene. Just as the good thief was given to understand the secret of the kingdom of Jesus, why should not Simon of Cyrene have been given a glimpse of the kingdom, piercing through his annoyance at having to carry a criminal's cross by the very act of doing so? Jesus' head is inclined towards Simon's. Simon seems to be listening. There is communication. Jesus is revealing to him the secret of the kingdom, the universal call of the human race to, as St. Paul writes in his letter to the Galatians, carry each other's burden and so fulfill the law of Christ. The background figures illustrates this, here and in the next station. As Matthew writes, "In so as far as you did it to the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did it to me." Simon helps Jesus unwillingly carry the cross. Nevertheless, he does help. Do we allow others to help us in times of great difficulty? By such an action, we evoke the Christian virtues of mercy and compassion. Do we go out of our way to help others in time of need? Lord, help us extend help willingly to our brothers and sisters when their burdens have become too heavy to carry.
Station 6, Veronica. Veronica means true image. This incident is not recorded in the Gospels, but it seems likely that the woman who followed Jesus did what they could to ease his suffering. Veronica has provided us with the ancient representations of the face of Christ, not made by human hands, venerated in the East. She has given us the face of the fairest of the children of man, as it says in the Psalms, in whose likeness we must grow. The image that must be impressed on our souls so that we might reflect his glory. It is your face, O Lord, that I seek. Hide not your face. Longing to see the face of Christ, to know what he really looked like, has inspired countless artists through the ages. It is a frightening challenge, too, seeing him face to face. This may be for us the cruelest test of whether we really love him. In John's letter, we read, "We shall be like him because we shall see him as he really is." Veronica liked the face of Jesus because she saw before her a suffering person, not knowing he was the Son of God. When do we have the opportunity to see the suffering Jesus and to offer to comfort him? When? It happens every day. Lord, we pray to love others as you have loved us.
Station 7, Jesus falls for the second time. Jesus falls because we fall. He became like one of us so that we may become like him. The crosses of the world, station number 3, which burden him, take on a more tragic dimension. They seem to batter him down, concentrating on his faltering figure to crush him totally and for good. We read in Isaiah, "The crosses above, the thorns below, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. Come to me, all of you who labor and are overburdened, and I will give you rest." The reading is from Matthew. What do we do when someone stumbles and falls again and again? Do we look around us for someone to blame? If we do, then we are stumbling too. We remember the homeless throughout the world, those who sleep rough in the big cities, many of whom have lost the will to rise up and carry on. Lord, be with all of us who stumble and fall, as you did on the road to Calvary, and prompt us to help others to rise and serve you.
Station 8, the Women of Jerusalem. St. Luke writes, if men use the green wood like this, what will happen when it is dry? Jesus is the green wood, his cross the tree of life, from which we draw all fruitfulness. St. John writes, I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever remains in me, with me in him, bears fruit in plenty. The cross is represented here as bursting with life. The women too are life bearers through suffering. St. John writes, Jesus wept. We recall how Jesus shed tears at the death of his friend Lazarus. Most people at some time in their lives are reduced to tears. May our tears not be shed in self-pity. May we, in such moments, rather weep for the sadness and tragedy of another person's life. Lord, we pray that when darkness engulfs us, your light will guide us to extend a helping hand to another in distress.
Station 9, Jesus falls the third time. The crosses are larger and heavier still, to the point of overwhelming Jesus. He is crushed to the ground. And we read in Lamentations, oh, how Yahweh in his wrath has brought darkness on the daughter of Zion. He has flung the glory of Israel from heaven to the ground. All who pass your way clap their hands at your sight. They whistle and shake their heads over the daughter of Jerusalem. Was this the loveliest of all? This the joy of the whole world? I am a man familiar with misery under the rod of his anger. I am the one he has driven and forced to walk in darkness and without any light. And now I say, my strength is gone, that hope which come from Yahweh. In Luke we read, Jesus says, Lord, if you are willing, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, let your will be done, not mine. We can link this fall of Jesus to his agony in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus, weighed down by the evil in the world, falls to the ground and cries out to his heavenly Father for strength to carry on. What a lesson for us. We remember so many persons in our material world searching for help in distress. Lord, hear our pleading, our cries of agony, and give us strength to overcome all evil.
Thank you.
not strip him of his dignity. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all other names. And we read in John, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we shall come to him and make our home with him." The Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, is prepared for sacrifice. His clothing is torn away from his body. Love is revealed in its starkest form. May we strip ourselves of all attachments to the things of the world in order that our crucified and risen Lord may dwell fully in us. Lord, we pray that, having emptied ourselves of all that separates us from you, the love of God may be revealed in us, as it was in our brother Jesus.
Station 11. Jesus is nailed to the cross. Jesus said, "Destroy this sanctuary, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The background shows the temple, which also stands for a city on the point of being bombed, as Jesus' body is on the point of being destroyed by the nails. Jesus suffers in the agonies of the human race until the end of time. St. John writes, "From that day, they were determined to kill him." The body of Jesus, the Son of God, is now secured to the instrument of torture, and people's inhumanity to another is revealed. But are things any different today? We reflect on the destruction and persecution of one race by another, and on the violence of crime today. And let us never forget our own failure to love our neighbour as Jesus taught us. Lord, we pray for all those in our world today whose intention is the destruction of another.
Station 12, Jesus speaks to his mother. Like station 4, this is an intermezzo of love and peace, a moment of warmth and communication. Though full of pain and distress, the focus here is not on the pierced hands and feet, nor the bombed city temple, but on the loving concern of three people. Mary, carrying the word, the sword in her heart, knows that God is love. and so does John. A lasting relationship is established between Mary and John, soon to be filled with the presence, soon to be filled with the presence of the risen Jesus. John took her into his home. John tells us that Jesus said, "Woman, this is your son. This is your mother." These words are the words of a dying man. No thought for himself, but for the two broken-hearted people who stood by the cross. His mother Mary and the disciple John, who were very dear to him. By these words he commends his mother, not only to John, but to us all. We think of those who are spending their lives alone and in hospitals and homes for the elderly. Lord, we pray for a greater concern for the well-being of the elderly in our society, especially those with no one to care for them.
Station 13. Jesus dies on the cross. Darkness is closing in. Confusion, chaos, despair. The background shows the bombed-out city, the temple of Jesus' body throughout the ages. The figures of the women standing by him, the soldiers and the people, having watched the execution, turn and walk away. Satisfied? Indifferent? Luke writes, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world." Before the mystery of the death of our Lord Jesus on the cross, we fall silent. Only adoration remains. We know that whatever suffering we have to undergo in this world, we are held in the hands of God. His cross is ours. Lord God, our Father, we thank you.
Station 14. Jesus is taken down from the cross. It is over. Silence and darkness envelop Calvary. Joseph of Arimathea did a courageous thing, asking for the body of Jesus. He risked being identified as one of his friends, an accusation which has caused Peter's fall. did not know about the resurrection, but unwittingly provided the scene for the events of Easter. Truly, this was the Son of God. Thus said one of his executioners. Thus said his disciples on the Sea of Galilee when Jesus calmed the waters. A profession of faith. We should all have these words on our lips. Jesus is taken down from the cross. Mary must have been there, and the women who followed Jesus. Mary shares the thoughts of all who hold close to them a loved one who has died. Lord, take all whom you have called from this world into your eternal light, your life, and your peace.
Station 15, Jesus is buried. Deeper darkness still. But in the deepest shadow of death, there is a glimmer of hope, of new life, symbolized by the ceiling. Jesus had said, I tell you most solemnly, unless the wheat grain falls on the ground and dies, it remains only a single grain. But if it dies, it yields a rich harvest. Easter expectations begin to shine through the sadness of Good Friday. John writes, at the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden. They laid Jesus there. The torment and agony of the crucifixion is over, and Jesus is laid to rest. He is at peace. But his spirit rises, and many of those who had fallen asleep are awakened. Lord, we pray that we may face death with the certain knowledge that we will live forever with you in Christ.